Taylor Swift has become one of the most influential pop artists of the 21st century. This book traces her rise from her early days as a country singer-songwriter in Nashville to her current worldwide fame as a chart-topping pop icon. The book's 15 chapters follow Swift's personal and professional trajectory, highlighting key moments that shaped her music and public image. Early chapters cover her childhood in Pennsylvania, moved to Nashville at age 14 to pursue music, and her first record deal with Big Machine Records as a teenager. Later chapters explore her evolution from country to pop with crossover hits like We Are Never Ever Getting Back Together, the making of genre-defining albums such as Red and 1989, her turn toward alternative pop on albums like Folklore, controversies around her public feuds and advocacy for artists' rights, her devoted fan base staying with her throughout her musical explorations, and the secrets behind her lasting cultural relevance. Ultimately, Taylor Swift from Nashville, starlet to global pop icon, reveals the disciplined songwriting craft and savvy public persona behind one of music's most extraordinary success stories. It offers an intimate look at a small-town girl who found her voice through music and grew into an empowered woman in control of her artistry. For Swift's millions of fans or anyone intrigued by her impact, it provides a comprehensive picture of a humble beginner transformed into a force majeure of modern pop. Chapter 1, Early Life and Childhood, Taylor. Allison Swift was born on December 13, 1989 in Reading, Pennsylvania. Her father, Scott Kingsley Swift, was a stockbroker for Merrill Lynch, and her mother, Andrea Gardner Swift, née Finley, was a homemaker who had previously worked as a mutual fund marketing executive. Swift was named after singer-songwriter James Taylor. Swift spent her early years on a Christmas tree farm that her father had purchased from one of his clients. She attended preschool and kindergarten at the Alvernia Montessori School, run by the Bernadine Franciscan sisters, before transferring to the Wincroft School. The family then moved to a rented house in the suburban town of Wyomissing, Pennsylvania, where Swift attended Wyomissing Area Junior-Senior High School. From a young age, Swift showed interest in musical theater and performed in many Berks Youth Theater Academy productions. She traveled regularly to New York City for vocal and acting lessons, becoming the only person in her class to be chosen for admission to the prestigious Berklee College of Music Summer Music Program. Her family later relocated to Hendersonville, Tennessee to support Swift's burgeoning music career. Chapter 2, Discovering Her Passion for Music. From a very young age, Taylor Swift showed a deep passion for music and performing. According to her mother, Swift's first exposure to music came when she was still in the womb. Her parents would often attend concerts, which Swift would react enthusiastically to, kicking whenever she heard the loud beats and sounds of rock bands like the Rolling Stones. As a toddler, Swift was drawn to the show tunes and musical soundtracks constantly playing around the house. She especially loved listening to the songs from Disney films and Broadway musicals like Les Miserables and Cats. By age 5, she was performing songs and dressing up for family members, showcasing intense creativity and lack of shyness on stage. Her favorite artists at the time were Dolly Parton and Leanne Rimes, and she dreamed of one day becoming a country star like her idols. When Swift was 8 years old, her parents took her to see the Broadway production of The Sound of Music in Pennsylvania, which they recount as a pivotal moment. Swift was utterly captivated by the show, sitting on the edge of her seat and singing along to every song. Afterwards, she announced to her parents that she was going to be an actress on Broadway one day. From that point on, her mother Andrea recognized and encouraged her intense obsession with performing. Andrea took Swift to singing and acting lessons in Pennsylvania to nurture her talents. Even as a young child, her vocal coach noted her perfect pitch and ability to learn songs incredibly fast, sometimes in just one take. By age 10, Swift was performing in children's theater, soaking up dance and vocal lessons, any chance she could get on stage. When Swift was 11, the family took a trip to Nashville, where she put together a portfolio of her hometown performance videos to bring around to record labels. The visit made a huge impression. Swift was enamored by Nashville's musical energy and told her parents, "This is where I need to be." She soon became singularly focused on pursuing country music. Swift worked tirelessly singing at local events in Pennsylvania, self-promoting her music at any opportunity. She traveled 2 hours weekly to vocal lessons in New York City, striving to improve her voice even as a young teenager. Her dedication paid off when she was chosen for admission to the Berklee College of Music's prestigious summer program at age 12, the youngest student ever accepted. There, Swift set her sights firmly on stardom. Her keyboard teacher at the camp remembered her determination, saying it was already quite evident that she was going to go somewhere. While her peers were busy going to football games and dances, Swift spent weekends performing at cafes, festivals, and fairs up and down the East Coast to earn money for her future demo tape. At age 14, the Swifts moved to Nashville full-time to support Taylor's dreams of a music career. She immediately began attending songwriter circles and networking with producers, demonstrating maturity and skill beyond her years. While still balancing high school, she relentlessly pursued a record contract, built relationships around town, and continued honing her songwriting craft and style of emotive country pop. Swift fully immersed herself in Nashville's music scene, seduced by the industry's energy. Despite being an outsider new to the South, her unique voice and drive set her apart. She landed an artist development deal with RCA Records at age 15, recognizing the keys would be staying humble and working nonstop to achieve success. The pieces were falling into place, but it would still take relentless dedication for the young upstart to break through in country music. Moving to Nashville and signing her first record deal. At age 14, Taylor Swift and her family made the pivotal move from Pennsylvania to Hendersonville, Tennessee, so she could actively pursue her musical dreams in nearby Nashville. While a massive change, Swift adapted quickly and immersed herself in Nashville's renowned country music scene. She relentlessly networked, attending industry events and songwriter circles, introducing herself to producers and music executives around the city. Just months after moving, Swift landed a developmental deal with RCA Records, working with the label to hone her writing skills as an aspiring country artist. She began homeschooling to accommodate her budding career, spending weekdays writing songs and learning about the industry from veteran music row songwriters like Troy Verges. They mentored Swift on crafting emotive country story songs from personal experience, a style she would soon perfect. By age 15, Swift was firming up her artistic identity and spent hours daily alone in her room working on lyrics and guitar chords. Her first true cut was The Outside, a touching song she pitched at a Nashville convention. The ballad got the attention of fledgling production company Big Machine Records, landing Swift her first artist meet and greet. At the Big Machine meeting, then CEO Scott Borchetta was instantly struck by Swift's presence and maturity. She confidently performed her original songs on guitar to Borchetta and promoter Mike Dungan. By the end, Borchetta offered Swift a development deal, wanting to build a label around the unique 16-year-old storyteller. Over the next year, Swift recorded new demos with esteemed Nashville producer Nathan Chapman to shop her songs around town, fine-tuning her songwriting abilities under Chapman's mentorship. At industry showcases, her honest, vulnerable performances impressed executives, including Scott Borchetta, who called her the voice of a generation. Finally, at age 16, Swift signed a formal artist deal with Big Machine Records to launch her debut album campaign. It was an indie label still recruiting staff and basically financed on Borchetta's line of credit. But he gave Swift full creative freedom, and they shared a vision to bring genuine, youthful country music back to the Nashville scene. To support Swift's early studio sessions, her father purchased a 3% stake in Big Machine Records for the essential startup capital. The small but mighty team helped Swift pick songs, develop her sound, and prepare to introduce herself to the country music world. Swift dove headfirst into finalizing her debut album plans with producers and managers. She self-penned songs like Tim McGraw and Our Song, drawing straight from her high school love and heartbreak. The tracks featured Swift's signature confessional, intimate songwriting anchored in catchy melodies. Leading up to the release, Swift promoted tirelessly, including an hour-long set at Nashville's iconic Bluebird Cafe, attended by major label scouts. Her glowing local buzz and charming personality on the chicken wing circuit captivated attendees. After her performance at the Bluebird, then CEO of Sony Music, Joe Galante, even approached Swift's parents trying to sign her. But she remained loyal to Scott Borchetta's vision. As 2007 pressed on and Swift neared her album launch, she continued honing her guitar and performance skills, practicing constantly before heading into the studio. Years of dedicated training were culminating in the chance to share her music with the world. Larger dreams of stardom drove Swift, but she stayed gracious and committed to small-town roots even as her career ignited. If you are enjoying the story, please hit that like button and subscribe to our channel to let us know you want us to continue to bring you great learning English from story videos. Chapter 4, releasing her debut album and rise to stardom. After years honing her songwriting and over a year recording, Taylor Swift's self-titled debut studio album Taylor Swift finally released on October 24, 2006, when she was just 16 years old. The album blended pop and country genres led by singles Tim McGraw, Teardrops on My Guitar, and Our Song, heartfelt relationship songs Swift penned as a high school teenager. Taylor Swift received glowing reviews praising Swift's honesty and lyricism. The New York Times applauded her small-town scale of her adolescence, showcasing a relatability beyond her years. Fans connected intensely with Swift giving voice to coming-of-age emotions through catchy melodies. Commercially, Taylor Swift hit number 5 on Billboard's Top Country Albums chart and number 39 on the main Billboard 200. Tim McGraw and Teardrops on My Guitar both reached Billboard's Hot Country Songs Top 10. Huge feats for a debut country act. But Swift connected even more powerfully with fans on the road. She toured radio stations relentlessly, shaking hands and chatting candidly. Her charisma and approachability helped Taylor Swift's singles and fame spread. Big Machine label groups, fledgling promotion, and PR teams also coordinated clever radio events and fan meet and greets to boost Swift's profile week by week. In early 2007, Swift supported Rascal Flatts on select dates during their Still Feels Good tour. She relished the arena sets as her first major tour stint, previewing songs from Taylor Swift. Flatts and fans welcomed Swift warmly, the crowd singing every word to Tim McGraw as Swift grinned ear to ear. Swift then toured radio shows herself 6 days a week. She'd bounce between cities visiting stations, performing acoustic sets and greeting every fan. It was vital grassroots promotion for Swift's rising stardom. Her schedule was grueling, but she insisted on prioritizing country audiences that had nurtured her whole career. Throughout 2007, Taylor Swift continued selling as newer fans discovered Swift's music on radio airwaves. By year's end, Swift's debut earned platinum status in the US and became the longest charting album of the 2000s on Billboard's Top Country Albums. On tour, Swift began headlining more intimate venues nationwide. Her sets mixed charming stage banter and fiery country pop performance. To support her soaring fame in summer 2008, Swift co-headlined an arena tour with Brad Paisley visiting amphitheaters nationwide. Together, they drew huge crowds, captivated by Swift as country music's newest darling. Swift ended 2007 opening select dates for George Strait's national tour. It capped a monumental year touring sold-out arenas, rubbing shoulders with country greats. Swift was also nominated for the Grammy Award for Best New Artist in 2008. She performed at the ceremony at just 18 years old, establishing herself as country's brightest rising talent. Taylor Swift ultimately stayed on Billboard's charts for 275 weeks, one of the 25 longest charting albums ever, fueling Swift's relentless rise. She cultivated intimate fan connections, touring small markets while topping charts and playing for packed arenas. With generational stardom in sight, Swift had only just begun unleashing her bold artistic vision to the world. Chapter 5, Fearless Era and Country Pop Crossover Appeal. Coming off her massively successful debut album, Taylor Swift, Swift embarked on her sophomore record Fearless throughout 2008, looking to showcase growth as both a person and musician. Fans witnessed her evolve from teenage country prodigy to independent woman as public relationship struggles shaped Swift's songwriting. At 18, Swift's music was also maturing. Fearless incorporated more pop production, reflecting her newfound confidence. Lyrically, though, intimate storytelling remained Swift's touchstone, mining wisdom from failed romances and friend breakups. Cathartic lead single Love Story depicted Swift fantasizing about finding her Romeo. Its fusion of yearning pop vocals over a banjo backdrop clicked with country and top 40 audiences, catapulting Swift further into the cultural zeitgeist. Fearless released in November 2008 to glowing reviews, especially around the emotional resonance Swift brought to adolescent experiences. Rolling Stone compared her nice girl charm to country legend Shania Twain's appeal, showcasing how Swift followed country superstars able to cross over to pop. As Swift rejected rigid genre walls between Nashville and top 40, she represented a new generation. Commercially, Fearless soared, selling 592,000 copies its opening week, the biggest debut of 2008 by a female artist. It topped Billboard charts for 11 weeks and was certified diamond by the RIAA. The album's fusion of wholesome songwriting and pop production spawned further hit singles like White Horse, 15, and You Belong With Me, which all reached number 1 or number 2 on Billboard's country charts. Swift promoted Fearless tirelessly on talk shows and radio events with infectious charisma. She shook every hand, carrying herself with wisdom beyond her teenage years. Industry heavy hitters took notice, including Stephen King calling Fearless the most splendid of splendors. Swift stayed grounded by writing songs fan first. She penned letters to individual supporters and wore fan-made gifts at concerts. Her Swifties felt understood by Swift singing about their age and saw her as their best friend. The intimacy paid dividends. By 2010, Fearless was the top-selling album of the year, with accolades accumulating, including Billboard's Artist of 2009. At the Grammys, 20-year-old Swift made history as the youngest winner ever of Album of the Year for Fearless. Her acceptance speech thanked every individual fan by name, underscoring her authenticity. With fame skyrocketing, Swift simply worked harder, writing 100-plus songs for her next album and planning her first stadium headlining tour. Swift emerged from the Fearless era as America's unlikely sweetheart, dominating both pop and country fans. As she approached her 20s, possibilities stayed endless for the generational talent backed by legions of supporters ready to grow up alongside their hero. With each album, Swift's music mirrored her personal growth into an independent musician and role model. Chapter 6, Speak Now and Establishing Herself as a Songwriter. Fresh off her massive Fearless Stadium tour, Swift retreated to Pennsylvania in late 2009 to start brainstorming her third record, Speak Now, at just 20 years old. She immersed herself in solitude to reflect on recent romantic ups and downs and channel it all into songwriting. Her sharp lyrical observations matured into nuanced poetry, detailing love's soaring highs and paralyzing lows. For the first time, Swift wrote an entire album alone, flying to meet producers after with finished songs in hand. She chased sonic growth, adding pop touches to her country confessions, working extensively with Nathan Chapman, who helped forge her signature sound. Lyrically, though, intimate personal storytelling took center stage. Speak Now released October 2010 to rave reviews, especially praising Swift's songwriting. Rolling Stone applauded her honesty, unpacking the romantic. Her self-awareness tackling love at 20 resonated widely with fans facing similar growing pains. Commercially, Speak Now moved 147,000 copies opening week, at the time a record for any female artist. It spent 6 weeks atop the Billboard 200 thanks to emotive pop crossover hits like Back to December, Mean and Hours, striking chords with wide audiences. On tour, Swift continued making every fan feel special with handwritten meet-and-greet letters and social media interactions. Her connection to supporters fueled Speak Now's success as it stayed Billboard's number one album for a total 16 weeks. Beyond sales, Speak Now marked Swift's artistic coming of age, formally establishing her esteemed songwriting prowess. She became Billboard's youngest ever solo writer, honored as Songwriter Artist of the Year. Speak Now also earned additional Grammy nominations, including coveted Album Song Record of the Year. While she didn't take home top awards, Swift's consistency crafting emotive pop catapulted the 21-year-old into rarefied air among music's top songwriters like peers Bob Dylan and Paul McCartney. Her catalog had unprecedented depth for someone so young. Ultimately, Speak Now signaled Swift settling into her musical identity rooted in confessional songwriting. Album 4 would embrace pop sounds even fully, but lyrical intimacy remained Swift's creative anchor. Her time alone penning Speak Now unlocked raw self-expression in her writing, poised to launch her into icon status. Chapter 7, Going Pop with Red and Global Superstardom. After Speak Now, Swift was ready to expand her sound into brave pop territory on 2012's Red. She incorporated varied influences like dubstep, electronic, and arena rock while preserving intimate songwriting. Tracks like We Are Never Ever Getting Back Together and I Knew You Were Trouble marked Swift's official transition toward mainstream pop. Red released in October 2012 to glowing reviews for Swift's genre meshing. Critics praised her fluid versatility, fusing country roots and pop production into something altogether modern. Commercially too, Red soared, selling 1.21 million copies opening week and dominating international charts as Swift's first true global smash. Swift promoted Red aggressively, performing TV spots and massive stadium shows overseas. She prioritized connecting with international crowds firsthand through trips to Australia, Asia, Europe. As Swift charmed foreign press and fans learned her songs by heart, her star ascended worldwide. By 2013, Swift had cemented herself as a pop culture phenomenon, dominating headlines for high-profile romantic relationships and female friendships in Hollywood that fueled songwriting. As media bulbs flashed daily and papped followed Swift's every move, she maintained down-home grace even under immense pressure. Swift leveraged fame for good, visiting children's hospitals between tour stops. She mentored aspiring young musicians, and following Red Track Means Grammy win, Swift donated proceeds to arts education. By 2014, Red had been on the Billboard 200 over two straight years and become Swift's best-selling album globally, certified diamond by RIAA. At just 24, Swift was officially the biggest pop star on the planet thanks to Red's genre-bending risks. For Swift, though, connecting through music remained her driving passion amidst celebrity whirlwinds. She looked ahead to Album 5 and further reinventing her sound. After conquering country and pop alike, Swift was already an icon, but she kept aiming higher sonically while still bearing her diary entries first and foremost. Chapter 9, Reputation, Controversies, and Public Image Shifts. On the heels of mega-hit 1989, Swift receded from the spotlight throughout 2016 to craft Darker's sixth album, Reputation. Fueling writing was intense backlash over public spats with figures like Kim Kardashian and Kanye West, that sparked accusations of Swift calculating her image. She explored reinventing herself amidst the complex femmes fatales narrative engulfing her reputation. When Reputation released November 2017, Swift appeared revamped, donning edgy fashion, snakes, and aggression over catchy trap-inflected production expanding her sound. Lyrically, though, songs like Delicate and Dress returned to her confessional core, revealing intimate insecurities and desires that humanized larger-than-life Swift. Critically, Reputation earned raves for its risks, expanding genre boundaries through hip-hop and EDM textures, while sustaining hallmark vulnerability. Commercially, too, it broke records, selling 2 million copies in its first week in the U.S., fans globally connected to Swift blending steeliness and sensitivity, navigating the chaos surrounding her reputation during fame's heights. Still, debates brewed over whether Swift was manipulating public perception or authentically reinventing herself creatively. Her evocative music videos and stadium tours suggesting tyrannical, rule-fueled discussions of women's control and power. By 2019, Reputation had spent over 2 years on the Billboard 200, aided by Swift's intimate fan interactions on social media and Netflix concert special. Swift emerged from Reputation's era with maturity from media storms, while showcasing resilience crafting her most adventurous album. Chapter 10, Lover and Increased Artistic Freedom. After confronting drama and controversies surrounding her reputation, Swift retreated from the spotlight in 2018 to work on seventh album Lover. She focused introspectively on finding love and happiness with longtime boyfriend Joe Alwyn. Lover crystallized Swift's versatile songwriting across 18 tracks spanning confident pop anthems, Me, Political Please, You Need to Calm Down, and intimate love songs, Lover. Sonically, Lover incorporated brighter production with guitars and orchestration, though lyrics remained central. Swift shared unprecedented personal details like her mother's cancer diagnosis. Critics praised Swift's musical flexibility and commended her LGBTQ advocacy in You Need to Calm Down, which called out online trolls and homophobia while celebrating identity. Released August 2019, Lover sold 867,000 copies its first week in the US, the year's biggest debut. Swift co-executive produced a Target Deluxe edition and released album track Lover early to boost sales, showing savvy business instincts. By 2020, it broke the record for most cumulative weeks on the Billboard 200 by a female artist, reflecting Swift's enduring fan base. Swift supported Lover with candid journal entries on social media and a color-drenched stadium spectacle on her Lover Fest tour before it was canceled due to COVID-19. While the era lacked a world tour, she fostered one-on-one fan connections through immersive Spotify playlists and YouTube live streams. Overall, Lover signified Swift being centered both personally and professionally. While fame inevitably involves some loss of control over public narratives, Lover showed Swift regained creative autonomy on her own terms. She freely blended genres and intimate songwriting, capturing all shades of love and life. Chapter 11, Folklore, Evermore, and Indie Folk Experimentation. In early 2020, when the COVID-19 pandemic hit, Swift channeled solitude and introspection into a new indie folk album, Folklore, written and recorded in isolation. She adopted the pseudonym William Bowery for songwriting credits, adding mystery. Sonically, Folklore introduced alternative sensibilities from bands Swift admired like The National, exploring layered vocals over mellow piano strings and minimalist percussion. Lyrically, Folklore saw Swift improvisationally pen story songs from different characters' perspectives, a technique she called character study writing. Tracks like Cardigan and August read like vignettes chronicling fabled small-town love affairs. The novelistic approach earned acclaim for Swift's lyrical finesse and versatility. A surprise July 2020 release, Folklore enchanted critics and debuted at number one. It marked Swift's eighth consecutive Billboard 200 chart topper, a feat unmatched by any female artist. Folklore also won Album of the Year at the 2021 Grammys, making Swift the first woman to take the honor three times. Just 5 months later, Swift dropped sister record Evermore, elaborating on Folklore's aesthetic with the same rich storytelling and alternative influences. Singles like Willow and Nobody No Crime continued her exploration of perspective-driven tales and genre-blending production. On the era's studio albums, Swift largely avoided tabloid drama and leaned into artistry. Without flashy videos or tours during lockdown, the music alone captivated fans. Swift later mused she loved the escapism of crafting folk characters and fictional universes through lyrical vignettes during quarantine. Overall, Folklore and Evermore exemplified Swift's versatility and emphasis on songwriting. Shedding her pop star skin, Swift tapped the emotional power of storytelling through sharp observations on love, loss, and small-town life over indie folk production. Her pandemic writing struck universal chords with fans globally. Chapter 12, Re-recordings and Owning Her Masters. Amidst celebrating her 30th birthday in 2019, Swift became embroiled in a heated public dispute over rights to her first six album masters that she didn't own. Her former label Big Machine sold them to Scooter Braun's company, igniting conversations around artists lacking control in the industry. In response, Swift pledged to re-record album tracks to regain ownership of her discography. She legally could perfectly recreate new versions that she would fully own herself under copyright law. Starting in late 2020, amidst the folklore era, Swift slowly unveiled re-recorded Fearless album cuts titled Taylor's Version. In April 2021, Swift released vault track Mr. Perfectly Fine from the Fearless re-recordings, showcasing similar magnetic vocals and pristine production quality a decade later. Its debut atop Billboard's Hot Country Songs chart made Swift the only artist ever with three songs charting simultaneously, illustrating fan appetite for the re-records. That same week, Swift fully released Fearless, Taylor's Version, meticulously recreating treasured country pop hits note for note with her matured vocals on songs like You Belong With Me and Love Story. Critics and supporters globally praised her flawless execution. Fearless, Taylor's Version, topped charts internationally, spurring industry debates about ethics, legacy, and power dynamics for top artists lacking creative autonomy. By summer 2021, Swift had re-recorded over half her catalog and immediately rewarded fans by incorporating six unreleased Fearless-era songs on the reissue. Swift soon confirmed she was hard at work reviving the next albums, intent on completely owning her musical contributions regardless of obstacles. Through the re-records, Swift displayed strength and conviction fighting to reclaim creative power. Beyond commercial motivations, her artistry cultivating emotional connections remained paramount. Swift's integrity persevered, perfecting the works closest to her supporters' hearts years later. Chapter 13, Continued Accolades, Achievements, and Philanthropy. By her early 30s, Swift had already made pop history multiple times over. She became the youngest person ever to win ACM Entertainer of the Year in 2011, and the first female artist to win Album of the Year at the Grammys three times in 2021. Commercially, Swift is the highest certified digital singles artist ever, according to Ari Adelaide. She sold over 200 million records worldwide with streaming numbers in the billions, underscoring her unprecedented global popularity. From topping charts to breaking concert ticket sale records, Swift continues setting new high bars for success. In 2018, her Reputation Stadium tour set the record for highest-grossing U.S. tour by a woman. A testament to her enduring multi-generational appeal, Swift still consistently dominates charts with a surprise album drops over 15 years into her career. Beyond accolades, Swift uses her platform supporting arts education and humanitarian causes from LGBTQ rights to disaster relief support. She frequently makes large financial contributions during crises and created Taylor Swift's City of Hope Fund supporting cancer research. Swift also mentors young musicians, once surprising a Manchester fan unable to afford music school with over $36,000 to fund her education. She pen uplifting reassurance letters that have gone viral and continues uplifting marginalized groups, cementing her status as a positive role model. Now with 19 total Grammys at just 33 years old, Swift holds the record for most Best Songwriter-Composer ins. Yet her humility and generosity showcase legitimate care for fans and social causes beyond the acclaim. Swift focuses efforts on amplifying young talent and spreads hope through relatable messages in her art into the 2030s and beyond. If you are enjoying the story, please take a moment to like the video. Please subscribe to our channel to let us know to continue to make great Learn English Through Stories videos. Chapter 14, Personal Life, Relationships, and Finding Love. In August 2023, Swift became romantically involved with NFL superstar Travis Kelce of the Kansas City Chiefs midway through her Eras tour. Their bond formed virtually after Kelce mentioned having a crush on Swift, then direct messaging about music led to visiting Swift on tour stops when possible. By October 2023, Swift and Kelce went Instagram official. Swift cheered on the Chiefs weekly alongside Kelce's family and friends as their relationship deepened long distance with her touring schedule. In February 2024, Swift supported Kelce at Super Bowl LV8, performing a medley of hits at the pregame concert before watching the Chiefs defeat the Eagles alongside Kelce's loved ones. Their visible affection affirmed Swift embracing companionship with the down-to-earth athlete between working hard on her ambitions. At 34, Swift acknowledges struggle balancing her unrelenting career drives and personal growth under public scrutiny. But in Kelce, friends, and family, she's built trusting support systems. After years hiding relationships from media glare, Swift refuses to settle and values partners respecting her autonomy as she navigates unprecedented fame. While the long-term future remains unclear, Swift currently relishes Kelsey rooting for her ambitious endeavors from touring to activism. Though now more protective of her love life, Swift's willingness to open up sharing milestones like attending Kelsey's landmark Super Bowl underscores personal happiness remains her top priority amidst continuing to shatter records. Chapter 15, The Eras Tour. In 2018, Swift's Reputation Stadium Tour broke the U.S. record for highest-grossing tour by a female artist. In 2023, at age 33, Swift somehow found ways to top her own feats, announcing The Eras Tour spanning her entire multifaceted catalog. True to its name, the tour highlights different musical eras Swift has explored since her 2006 debut. The ambitious, complexly staged spectacle is her longest and biggest production yet, at over 150 shows across 5 continents over 20 months. Kicking off in March 2023, each performance relives the distinct vibes of albums spanning country roots and sundresses to edgy pop sequins for Reputation to intimate folklore woodsiness, showcasing Swift's versatility. Augmented reality immerses fans in interactive experiences between sets. By November 2023, the Eras Tour had already broken Swift's own record, grossing over $450 million in the U.S., capping an era-defining year for Swift after releasing Midnights and winning major Grammy victories. When the Eras Tour picks back up in February 2024, Swift has added 25-plus new dates through August, including 5 record-breaking nights at SoFi Stadium. Demand continues skyrocketing, with Swift pioneering industry shakeups like dynamic ticket pricing and special fan pre-sales to improve access. At 34, Swift is seizing fans globally on what may be the greatest tour in history. Not just breaking financial records, but also memorializing musical growth across the eras. While now prioritizing balance with relationships too, Swift remains devoted to the electric ambition and vulnerability on stage that have defined her connection to supporters for over 15 years and counting. Chapter 16, Legacy and Cultural Impact. With 19 Grammys and over 200 million albums sold, Swift's commercial statistics affirm her as one of music's elite artists historically at just age 34. But beyond sales, her sincerity and emotional vulnerability have cultivated a uniquely intimate connection with fans spanning over 15 years. Swift's willingness to draw inspiration directly from personal diary entries in her lyrics has catalyzed an entire confessional pop culture movement. Modern female singers like Olivia Rodrigo and Maisie Peters model Swift's trademark intimacy in songwriting. Likewise, Swift speaking out about politics, sexual assault, and equality has established her as a role model for social advocacy among young people. Her uplifting reassurance letters going viral demonstrate pan-generational influence, affirming fans' self-worth beyond any statistic. Even stylistically, Swift has repeatedly set global fashion trends, from red lipstick sales surging after she wore it to popularizing polka dot dresses. Vogue deemed her one of the world's most influential fashion icons, reflecting her cultural sway beyond just music. Now on the biggest tour of her career, Swift's concerts also spotlight next-gen artists she's mentored, like Gracie Abrams and Gayle, who cite her inspiration. Swift uses the enormous Eras Tour platform to showcase young talent following her lead. With Midnight cementing her as Spotify's most streamed artist ever, Swift keeps breaking records and inspiring new talent. But her connection to people moved by her self-disclosing art remains her hallmark legacy, regardless of accolades. Conclusion: Taylor Swift's path from teenage country prodigy to global pop icon over the past 15 years represents one of music's most extraordinary stories. Through concert tours, shattering financial records, and surprise album drops consistently dominating charts, Swift has firmly established herself as both a commercial juggernaut and peerless creative force. Yet beyond the staggering statistical superlatives, Swift's sincerity and emotional intimacy have cultivated a uniquely devoted fan base. Her willingness to draw directly from personal diary entries about love, heartbreak, and self-discovery has catalyzed an entire culture celebrating that radical vulnerability in pop music. Swift gives voice not to a carefully curated persona, but rather her genuine complexities as she's navigated early fame and adulthood entirely in the public eye. It's this relatability that cements Swift's cultural legacy regardless of commercial benchmarks. She's become a role model for young people through eloquently championing equality, advocating on politics, and maintaining humility even amidst stratospheric celebrity. The resonance of her honest music and songwriting across demographic boundaries points to Swift cementing her influence for generations. As Swift progresses ever deeper into her 30s while sustaining record-shattering dominance of pop culture, her continued prioritization of personal growth and joy grounds enduring ambition. By all indications, the icon, truly coming into her own creatively and personally, still has her most compelling chapters ahead. Swift has already redefined the possibilities for artists shaping discourse through courageous self-expression. So as she elevates new voices while reaching ever bigger audiences on the era's mega tour, Swift's honesty and connection with supporters remain her greatest legacy, regardless of whatever history she makes next. Thanks for watching the video. Please subscribe to our channel if you think this video will help you learn better English.